Wow. Look what happens when you have a little bit of rain. You can turn me down a little bit. There's not too many in here. Oh, amen. It is a cold rain. All right. Well, we're going to go ahead and start tonight, and we're glad that you're here. That's what matters. And I was telling my brother Skip and I was talking, you know, over the years I have preached to my wife and two sons. That was my congregation. And I have preached in crusades to over 65,000 people. So I went from one extreme to another extreme. So numbers don't affect me. The power and the Spirit of God is what it's all about. And we're glad you're here tonight, and maybe a few more will be coming in. Tomorrow night, obviously, New Year's Eve, we're not going to have service. We had service. I chose to do it tonight for different reasons. I just believe it's very important because we've missed so much service over the last several months. I just felt it very important to get back into gear of our regular services and that, and begin to build from there. So we're glad that you're here tonight, and I know God's going to bless you. Tonight we're going to start a teaching on a series, and the series that we're going to be teaching on Wednesday night is on the deity of Jesus Christ. The reason we're doing that is because the more that the world moves toward a one-world government and a one-world religion, the only way you can do that is to bring Jesus down to a level with all the other religious leaders. And if he's on a common denominator, a good guy, then it will be easy to push the one religious and one church. But as long as Jesus is considered God, it's kind of hard to do, all right? It kind of trumps them all, no pun intended. But so it's very important. And a lot of times people ask me about why do I preach on doctrine as much as I do? Because it is the foundation of our faith. Other things come, and different ideas and opinions and different ways of expressing ourselves. And there's a lot of preaching today that is full of self-help type situations. And I don't condemn any of that. I just know that the Word of God is what is going to not pass away. Amen? It will be here forever. And so tonight we're just going to get into the Word after our praise and worship. And so let's all stand, and we're going to ask the Lord to be with us tonight. Amen. Father, tonight we just come to you, and we thank you, Lord, for those that have come out in this weather, Lord, to be in the house of God, to be in fellowship one with another. And Lord, I thank you for their commitment. I thank you, Lord, for their heart's desire to be together. Father, I pray tonight, God, that they will receive from the Word of God. And Lord, I also ask tonight, God, for many of our families that are traveling, Lord, you keep your hands upon them. Lord, tomorrow night, Lord, many will be on the road traveling, visiting with families. Lord, protect them, Lord, with your love and your mercy and your grace. Father, I pray, God, that you would just shower them with your blessings. Bless us tonight, Lord, as we continue to move forward and do for the kingdom of God. So, Lord, we give you all the praise, honor, and glory tonight. In the precious name of Jesus Christ, we pray. And everybody says, amen. Remain standing. Let's worship the Lord.
We pray. the will of God and man align. And with one voice we lift our hands to say, we only trust in Jesus' name. Lord of mercy, hear this prayer. Thank you. we pray to you. Father, we lift our prayers today to you, God, for this nation, Lord. Give you glory and honor for all that you are and all that you do, Lord. In Jesus' name.
Jesus, Jesus. I just wanna be where you are.
Praise offering. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God is so good to us. You know that? He's so incredibly good to us. Oh, when you've been in His presence, you just don't want to be anywhere else. And that's all there is to it. You can be seated, and we're just going to turn the lights on. And tonight, I'm going to move the pulpit down here, and that way we can be a little bit closer to you. The reason I have it up there so in the back they can see easier, but that means Brandy's got to move up front. but anyhow, we're going to share tonight, and what I'm going to share tonight is very, very important. So once we get started here, we get everything down. All right. There we go. We're going to dismiss our youth at this time so they can be dismissed, and our children. We're excited about them. Doing a lot of work, trying to get everything set, get everything ready for our great inflow that we know is coming. You say, well, how do you know it's coming? Because we ain't never been fought so hard. That's one of the reasons I know. Amen. So what we're going to do is try to get everything lined up. How's it looking back there? Looking good? I mean, I know I am, but how's the camera look? The reason I wanted to move it up closer, and that way people who are watching online don't see an empty building. But they never see an empty building. They always see the back of Brother Skip's white hair. All right, he's always in every one, just right there he is. And so everybody knows who he is, okay? Tonight, I'm going to share something. We're going to start on a kind of a series. We're going to talk about the deity of Jesus. One of the reasons that I feel it's very important for us to begin to look at his deity. I know everybody wants to come to church and learn how to be a millionaire, and have all the toys and all that kind of stuff. Well, you're probably not in the right place, all right, because that's really not my mainstay. I believe God wants to bless us. I believe in prosperity. I believe God wants to help us to be rich so we can be a blessing and be a help to those around the world, and we can give. Be blessed to be a blessing, not be blessed just to get more stuff for ourselves. But we just finished about a five-month or six-month series going through the book of Revelation. I enjoyed it immensely. I hope people got something out of it. That was your place to say amen. But we had a great time during it. And then, of course, we got sidetracked with all the other nonsense that's going on in the world. But anyhow, we got through that. But while we were looking at Revelations, especially in these latter few weeks, when we began to look at, I'll try to stay in my box, okay? We began to realize that, you know, we talked about Babylon. We talked about a one-world religion. We talked about a one-world economical system. And we realized that it is going to be a reality. But we also know that when we got into Revelations, especially Revelations 21, parts of 20, 21, 22, that the Lord says, I'm going to end that system. I'm going to come down and I'm going to literally destroy that system. And I'm going to set up my system, my kingdom. And you and I are going to come back with him and rule and reign for the 1,000 years. But while we were looking at that, there was something that really struck in my heart. And what really struck in my heart, I said a little bit in the very beginning, is that in order to have a one-world system, you're never going to have a one-world religious church system as long as out of all of the different religious leaders, one of them is God. All right? How many of you know that if one of them is God, then you're going to gravitate toward God? But now, if all of them are on an equal playing field, let's say they're good men, they're good teachers, or they're good prophets, then what's the difference of who we worship? Why don't we just all come together and coexist as one religious body? Because after all, there really is no one religious leader who is God or is above the other leaders. Now, that will be in the next few years, that's going to be the push and the drive that we're going to begin to see. We've already seen it to some degree. All right, I can go to a meeting and I can pray in the name of the Father, Father God. I can pray to the man upstairs or the great power, the great being or whatever. And generally, I have no problems and there's no issues. But if I start using the name of Jesus, then I start getting into trouble, all right? Pastor, can you pray more of a generic prayer? Well, no, this pastor can't pray a more generic prayer, all right? And I'm not going to pray a more generic prayer because I believe that there is power in the name of Jesus. As a matter of fact, that's how you have been told by Jesus to pray. Ask anything of my Father in my name, and he shall give it and grant it unto you. So we've been told how to pray to the Father in the name of Jesus for the petitions that we have need of. So let's begin to look at some things. Now, I want to be very kind tonight. So for those of you watching and who have joined us on Facebook or you're going to the archives with YouTube, I'm going to look at different ways that people view Jesus organizations. I'm not going to call out the names in particular. I will one, and that's Islam. And I want to make a very clear distinction there. But some of the others, most of you may have friends or families in these organizations. So I don't want someone to accuse, well, that preacher at River of Life, all he does is get in the pulpit and criticize and down other religions, all right? So I'm not going to call their name. I'm going to just call what they believe, all right? And how it differs from what you and I believe as a Christian, okay? So first of all, let me tell you, there are not many ways to heaven. There is only one way to heaven, and that's through Jesus Christ, all right? There is no other roads. Listen, all roads may lead to Kemp, but all roads don't lead to heaven, all right? All right, so you got to understand that. So let's look just for a moment. For a century, human beings have discussed, they've reasoned, they've rationalized who the person of Jesus Christ is. We've heard arguments for decades of who this man Jesus really is. We just got through celebrating his birth last week. Many people literally believe that he was born, came into this world in the manger. I am one of them, all right? I believe that. I believe that he was God incarnate, came from heaven in a fleshly body in order to reunite us and bring us back into fellowship with his Father, God. Man had been out of fellowship with God. Man had killed the prophets, and every time God tried to bring them back unto himself, they would kill them. They got rid of them one way or the other. Even when God said, I'll send my only son, surely they'll not kill him. And yet Jesus ends up being betrayed and he willingly laid his life down upon the cross. So it's been for a long time. It's worth noting that virtually every cult group begins with a misconception or a perversion of the nature of the person of Jesus Christ. Because they have a different view of Jesus, most of them are not able to put forth an orthodox Christian understanding. So when I say an orthodox view of Christianity, I mean simply we believe in one God. We believe God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. We believe Jesus came into this world. We believe he was born of the Virgin. We believe that he grew up. He ultimately suffered under Pontius Pilate. He was put to death. He was buried in the grave. He rose the third day, and he was sitting at the right hand of the Father. And when the Father speaks and says it's time to come, he will come back. The second return of the Lord will come back. And the Bible lets us know that the sea and the death, hell, and the grave give up those that are within it. There will be a judgment. There's eternal punishment for the wicked. There's eternal life for the righteous. That's basically what we believe as Christians. Jesus Christ is the kingpin, if I can say, that all of that hinges upon. It evolves around Jesus Christ. Many theories have risen as to who he is, and here are some of those misconceptions. So now I want you, as I read these, I want you in your mind to go like, uh-oh, that ain't right. That's not what the scripture says, okay? I want you to find that, all right? Here's one of them. One organization believes that Jesus is the Archangel Michael, the first being that Jehovah created in the universe. Their particular magazines and their writings say there is scriptural evidence for concluding that Michael was the name of Jesus Christ before he left heaven and after his return. They also say Michael, the great prince, is none other than Jesus Christ himself. Now, what in your mind is, when you look at the scriptures, what comes to your mind when you hear something like that, Donald? Not true. Okay, it's a false belief. But what is being said? Think about it. How does that contradict Scripture? Remember now, in Colossians, the Scripture says that all things were created by Christ. All things are from Him, through Him, ultimately back unto Him. And the Scripture says nothing that is created was created by anyone other than Christ Jesus. Now listen to what it says. They believe that the Archangel Michael, being Jehovah, created, being the first being that Jehovah created in the universe. Now, if Jesus was Michael the Archangel, then he was a created being. But the Scripture tells us that he was not a created being, but he was indeed God who came into this world and was made flesh. Some say that he is no higher than an angel. Did you know an angel cannot be everywhere? Do you know an angel is limited to where he can be? Do you know an angel is limited to his ability? An angel is limited to knowledge. An angel is limited. It can only do that which it is assigned to do. Now, what's the difference between an angel that is limited and God, Christ Jesus, who is all knowledge, all power, everywhere at the same time? That simply means that the difference between Christ and the difference between an angel is an angel was created, Jesus created the angels, all creation was made by him. An angel cannot be everywhere and do all things and be all powerful, yet Jesus is everywhere, all powerful, almighty, and therefore you and ministering unto you. Amen? So, first of all, their concept is totally contrary to the Word of God. So how do you open the Bible and get something so contrary to the Scriptures? Well, generally, most groups write their own Bible. They take the King James Version, generally, and then they begin to alter it. And they begin to say, well, maybe this is what it's really saying, and literally alter it. And the first two or three groups that I'm going to talk about, that's exactly what they did. They took the Word of God and they created their own Bible from it by adding to it and subtracting from it. But what did Revelation say when we closed the book the other day? Woe to those that add or take away from the Word of God. It's not to have one jot or tittle. And what that simply means is you better put every dot, every period, dot every I, cross every T, and keep it that way. That's why the safest translations that you and I can get is the original Hebrew or the original Greek. Because even the King James has some discrepancies in it. Nothing to do with salvation, but there's some these and thans and ands and conjunctions and things that are emphasized that may not have been the intent of the original writer. Let me look at another group for a moment. Jesus, they teach that Jesus Christ was the first begotten spirit child of the Father, Elohim. And one of his many unnamed wives, often referred to as the Heavenly Mother. Jesus, as a spirit son, then progresses in the spirit world until he became a God. Christ, by obedience and devotion to the truth, attained that pinnacle of intelligence which ranked him as a God. Well, give me a scripture, somebody, really quick, that debunks this. Also the other one. John, what is it? John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. So Christ has always been. There's never been a time to where Christ has not been. And that's hard for us to grab hold of, because in our mind, we believe that Jesus began last week when we celebrate Christmas in Bethlehem in a manger. That's when he began. That's when he came into the world. No, he's always been. And that's the power that we have lost in the body of Christ. Because if we look at an individual, a man who came into this world, a flesh rather, God in the flesh, and we look at that and we say, well, he's limited to what he can do because he's in the flesh. But yet he's God. He was there in the very creation. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, that says, let us now make man in our image, Elohim, which is plural, and so in the image of God, he created man. So we realize that the one who hung on the cross for you and I was not just a fleshly man. That was the body that housed the pre-incarnate Christ that has always been, is, and always will be. So we realize that the one that died on the cross of Calvary, the physical man was Jesus, but it was God who came and was willing to become a supreme sacrifice through Jesus Christ. Well, there's some other discrepancy here. Jesus, as a spirit son, then progressed in the spirit world. Nowhere in the scriptures are you going to find anything about Jesus having a spirit mother. Nowhere. It's not in the Word. It's not there. Now, why is this important? Because these are some of the things we're going to be confronted with not too long from now. Because everything's going to try to pull Christ down and put him on the same level as what the other leaders are, whether it's Allah, whether it's Buddha, Muhammad, whatever it might be. They're all going to be trying to put them on a same level playing field, and that way they can begin to push a one religious system. But you and I have to understand, we serve a living God, not a dead God. We serve a living God who died for you and I. Can you say amen? Let's look at another one. Now, this one I'm going to call out, and this is Islam. The reason I call it out is because it's becoming very strong. It's becoming very, very widely accepted. And in our country, we're seeing more and more. Now, I've talked to you in the past about how Islam works. Now, I know this is not politically correct. Okay, I understand that. But here's how it works. When it's a minority, they go along with anything and everything. When it becomes, when they become stronger and more populous, more in the people, then they become a little bit more emboldened. When they become the majority, that's when they begin to express themselves fully, and that's when persecution to the Christians becomes more and more. So here's what happens. Northern Nigeria, I've spent a lot of time in that area. The area where we work at in Kano is 99 over 99% Muslim. It's a very violent area. The Boko Haram and a lot of terrorist groups are based out of that area and north of there. Here's what happens. You go into the area. There were 36 states in Nigeria. And at one time, the majority of the nation was Christian. The northern area, which is populated by the Hausa tribes, which is mostly Muslim tribes. And so here's what happens. We just want Islam for us. We don't want to force it on anybody else. We're not going to worry about you. We just want to rule and govern our people under the Sharia law. Okay, well, we'll pass the Sharia law. Now, if you've never read the Sharia law, I'm telling you, you might want to go to the library and get a copy and read it. It might scare you half to death, okay? If a woman is seen with anyone, any male individual that's not a relative, she's subject to being stoned. Your hands are cut off if you steal things. It's horrible. But let's move forward. Well, we got more and more people now, so we want Sharia law. But we'll only put it on us. We won't put it on Christians or someone else. But now you become more, and now you become the dominant, and now you could simply say, no, anyone in our area, you are going to live by the Sharia law, and that simply means I can honor kill. And what that simply means is if someone in the family, especially a girl, a lady in the family says, I want to convert to Christianity, many times they're beaten. Many times, literally, their heads are cut off. It's not a pretty picture, all right? But they gain control. In Nigeria now, 13 of the northern states are under Sharia law. And it's moving ultimately to try to take the whole nation. The goal is to make it an Islamic nation. But now let's talk about it spiritually. Islam teaches that Jesus was one of many, many thousands of prophets. Islam teaches that Jesus was not God in human flesh, and that he was not the Son of God. This is from their writings. Jesus was no more than a mortal whom Allah favored and made an example to the Israelites. They also say that they do blaspheme who say God is Christ, the Son of Mary. Christ, the Son of Mary, was no more than an apostle. Now, this is from their holy scriptures, from the Quran. So do you understand the difference? One simply says Jesus is just an angel. Another one says that Jesus is a spirit son, and he ultimately became intelligent enough to be called the Son of God. Islam says that he was just one of many prophets. But you got to wait and hear a few of the other ones. Another group teaches that Jesus was an enlightened man, but not God. According to their particular writings, enlightenment occurs when a person reaches a place when all the negative aspects of the mind have been completely eliminated and one has reached a perfection of all positive qualities. Not a negative thought in your brain. Wonder how that's working out right now. There's another belief that Jesus could be the latest incarnation of Krishna. Many Hindus believe that Jesus was a good teacher, and perhaps one of their 330 million incarnations of God that has come into this world. I remember when I was working with Emmanuel Kumar. So Well, Emmanuel, if you're watching, you probably remember our conversation. I hadn't been to India, and this was my first time there. And when I got off the plane, he asked me, what did I think? And, you know, what did I feel? And I said, I just feel confusion. Now, I didn't know the statistics. I said, I just feel totally like a spirit of confusion. And when he asked me a little bit more, I just thought, you know, it just seems like there's just a lot of confusion here. And then I asked him, I said, how many gods are there? And he said, well, at last count, there was 330 million or 360 million. I said, well, no wonder I feel confused, all right? How in the world am I supposed to know which God to worship? But every so often, there's a being that comes in, and they're worshiped as a god. Sometimes it can be a roach. Sometimes it can be a cow. Sometimes it can be an elephant or a monkey. And that's why if you look at their idols, many of them are half man and half animal. A lot of them are. But anyway, that particular belief believes that there is that many. What's Isaiah say about God? God says, I am God. I am the only God, and I am a jealous God. Above me, there is no other. I am God. Period. So see, every one of these things that we're talking about goes contrary to our understanding of who Jesus Christ really, really is. And time won't permit me to go through all of them, but we'll just kind of leave it where we're at right now. Tonight, I want to share with you the difference in the different belief systems. I want you to look at the Word of God now. Here's what Thomas calls Jesus. John 20, verses 27 through 29. After seeing Jesus raised from the dead, Thomas answered and said to him, my Lord and my God. See, there's a distinction between someone being a great prophet, even being an apostle, or being an angel. Thomas said, he is my Lord and my God. Thomas was a Hebrew. He was a believer. And for him to call Jesus my God was equivalent to him saying, Jesus is none other than Jehovah. It was the same thing. Look at the Apostle Peter. 2 Peter 1 and 1. To those who have obtained like precious faith with us by the righteousness of our God and Savior Jesus Christ. The Greek literally reads this way. Having faith in the righteousness of the God of us and our Savior Jesus Christ. Peter said he is God. Thomas said, he is God. With the use of the way it is described, the God and Savior, we understand how he really saw him. Simply stated, he's God. Okay, well, look at Apostle Paul. The apostle called Jesus God. Titus 2:13. Looking for a blessed hope and a glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Again, we're looking at the literal Greek reading says, expecting the blessed hope and the appearance of the glory of the great God and Savior of us, Jesus Christ. Now, in the Word of God, there do not make a distinction, James. The Word says he is God, he is our Savior, he's Jesus Christ. He's not someone who was just created. He is not someone who went through a cycle of reincarnation to get to a certain level and be called God. He's not just a good man. He's not just another prophet. He's not just part of 330 different million avatars or different reincarnations. He is God. But the powerful part of him being God Just put that for a moment over on the side. He's God. But all of them are telling us something else. What is the rest? What are they saying in the rest of it? He is God and our Lord and Savior. Hallelujah. See, no other faith teaches that their God saves you. We are the only one that teach in the Christian faith that our God literally saves us from eternal damnation. He saves us from the world in which we're a part of to take us back and be with Him. No other faith does that. That's why we cannot be a conglomeration of religions thrown together. We stand separate. We do not worship a God that is afar off. We do not worship a God that is dead. We do not worship a God that is buried somewhere, but we worship a risen Savior who died for you and I on the cross of Calvary, and that makes it a whole different ball game for you and I compared to the other faiths in this world. Again, when we look at what's being said here, Jesus, the Christ, is being called again. He's being called God. And to me, that is incredible when we think about it. 2 Thessalonians 1:12, so that the name of our Lord Jesus will be glorified in you and you in Him, according to the grace of our God and what? Our Lord Jesus Christ. There's no question what the apostles understood Jesus to be. He is God incarnate, coming into this world, and not only is He God, but He's our Lord, and He's our Savior. He's the one we worship. He's the one we adore. He's the one that we pour our heart out to, and He is our Savior. He has redeemed us and changed our life. Romans 9. 5. Whose are the fathers? And from whom is the Christ according to the flesh? Who is over all? God blessed forever. Amen. Whose are the fathers? And from whom is the Christ according to the flesh? Who is over all? God blessed forever. God. Now, let's look at Apostle John. What did he say? John 1, 1 through 3 and 14. In the beginning, and we shared it for a moment. In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word, what? Was God, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. This verse is so damaging to many of those who do not profess Christ to be God. So generally what is done is in their translations, they change the wording to fit their theology instead of letting the Bible determine their theology. See, our theology is determined by the Word of God. We don't have a theology and then try to make the Word of God line up to what I believe. I believe what the Word of God says. So they change it, and the way some of it is read in one of their translations, basically, well, there's different terms for God. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word, I love it. And the Word was with God. And the Word was God, and God in every one of those statements is the same Word that's being used. He's God the Creator. He's God the Father. He's God. He's the living Word of God. As a matter of fact, when we look at the Bible, first of all, the Bible is on a piece of paper, okay? And it's written in black ink, and in some Bibles it's got red ink, okay? It's not the paper, but it's that Word that is living. inside of you. And when you read the word, it becomes a rhema word, and it builds up with inside of us. And all of a sudden, the full understanding and revelation of Jesus becomes so real to you and I that we walk in the fullness and the power of that word because it's become alive within the inside of us. See, I can preach all kinds of positive things to you. I can tell you, how you're blessed and you're a child of God. And because you're a child of God, He's your dad, and your dad wants to give you good things. So ask whatever you want, and you'll get it from God. And I can go on and on, but I would rather you get the Word of God, and the Word of God speak to your heart, a rhema word, and says, I am the Lord your God, and I will provide all of your needs. Amen. I've not seen any of my children begging bread. When those become real in your heart, you speak them in full power and authority. That's when your miracles come to pass. The prophet Isaiah said that the Messiah would be called God. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder. His name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Mighty God. Mighty God. He's a mighty God, girl. I mean, can you imagine? The creator of the whole universe gets up every morning with me. Goes everywhere I go. I sit down and have my morning cup of coffee. He's there. He may not be drinking coffee, but he's there. He's a mighty God. And we go through this life feeling like we're all by ourselves. And we feel like we're fighting all these battles by ourselves. I'm so proud of this church. I ain't got words. We come through a lot this last few months. It's about everybody in here. Not everybody, but close to it. Got zapped. All right? And you know, those that were the most vulnerable, you know, I've never heard one complaint from any of them. Never have. We just picked up and we kept going. Why? Because we serve a mighty God. We serve a mighty God. I have to admit, Rick, when they told me that you tested positive and all the health conditions you had? Well, on their list out there, you shouldn't be sitting there no more. You should have been gone already. All right? But we serve a mighty God. We serve a God who is with us all the time. He doesn't leave us. I don't know where Tony went. He was here earlier. But Tony's the same way. And there were many, John, I can name several names. They were on that short list. Skip. They were on a short list. Nancy and I, because of our age and some of the other conditions that I have, we were on a short list. But we serve a mighty God. I don't serve a created being. I don't serve an idol. I don't serve someone who is a cosmic being. I serve a mighty God, a God who created the heavens and the earth, a God who saves us, a God who redeemed us and delivered us, a God who heals us and keeps us in His everlasting care. God, we can have faith in. There's a story. I don't share it all the time. It's in the Apocrypha. If you are familiar with the Catholic Bible, the Douay Bible in particular, there are, I think, 13 books in it that we don't have. I'm not going to go through a theology class as to why they're there. All right, that would take a long time. But suffice it to say, what we have is canonized and it's good to go. But in the Apocrypha, there is one book, and it's called Bell and the Dragon. And it's kind of comical. It's a story that supposedly happened to Daniel, all right? And there was an idol, and then there was the Ark of the Covenant. And the Ark of the Covenant was next to the idol. And when they would go in there, they would put food by the idol. All right, and they'd come in the next day, and those that worshiped the idol would say, hey, see, our idol is a living God. He ate all the food. And so they would do it again another night. And they'd come back, our idol's a living God. He ate all the food. And this happened several times. So finally, supposedly, Daniel goes in and he sprinkles a fine powder on the floor that you can't really see. And when they go in the next day, see, the food's all gone, and our idol is a god. And Daniel said, yeah, they look at the footprints of the people who came in and ate the food. And it's just proven that you and I aren't serving an idol god. We're serving a real God. And do you know what happens? All of a sudden, the idol falls over. It can't stand. Years ago in the Philippines, there were several idols in the street, in the squares. And the churches got together and began to do praise and worship. And they would praise and worship for like 24 hours, just praising and worshiping God. And the lights went off. They had no electricity. It was a good old Filipino brownout. And so they took the cars and the Jeeps and everything, and they pointed them into the churches, and they turned the headlights on and continued to praise God, worship God. While they were worshiping God, these idols in the cities were falling off of their pedestal. They didn't need anybody to pull them down. The power of a mighty God did the work. And the statues were tumbling down. You know, we got to pull them down, right? But God knows how to knock them down, and because we serve a mighty, mighty God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hebrews 1:8, but to the Son he says, your throne, O God, is forever and forever. Your throne, O God, is forever and ever. You cannot deny the word. I got 25 of these, and I won't go through all of them, okay? I promise. Just like the Father, Jesus created all things. John 1:3. All things were made through him, and without him, nothing was made that was made. It cannot be a created being. He could not create himself. He was God, and he created all things. So that makes him more than an angel. That makes him God. Colossians, again, the scripture I referred to earlier, Colossians 1:16, for by him all things were created that are in the heavens and on earth, visible and invisible. Well, I've always wondered what the invisible things were that he created. Can you imagine? Oh, we have no concept of the power and the might of Almighty God to create everything that we see. And then to know that there's things out there that he created that we haven't even seen yet. How many of you got to see the Bethlehem star? Wasn't that powerful? It's incredible, wasn't it? 800 years, the last time it appeared. And your generation got to see it again. It won't happen for another 800 to 1,000 years. I don't know that we'll even be around. Well, I know we won't be around this group. I don't know if Earth will even be around. I mean, that's what I meant to say. No, we can't hang in that long, Rick. All right. Genesis 1:1, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Psalms 102, I said, oh my God, of old you laid the foundations of the earth, and the heavens are the work of your hands. It's who we serve. See, none of these things are ascribed to any of the other quote-unquote religious leaders or the other prophets or the Muhammads or any of that. This is given only unto Jesus Christ. That's why he's divine. Just like the Father, Jesus is called the Lord of Lords. 1 Timothy 6:15, which he, Jesus, will manifest in his own time, he who is the blessed and the only one, the King of kings and the Lord of lords. Isn't that what's going to be written on his vesture when he comes back? King of kings and Lord of lords. He'll be riding on the white stallion. And you and I are going to be right behind him somewhere. So I know there's got to be horses in heaven. We're going to come back on them. Hallelujah. Now, if your dog dies, I don't know that he goes to heaven, but I know there's horses in heaven. Revelations 19:16. And he has on his robe, what I just shared, on his thigh, a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Look at Deuteronomy 10:17. For the Lord your God is God of gods and Lord of lords, the great God. Oh, give thanks to the Lord of lords for his mercy, what? Endures forever and ever. And just like the Father, Jesus is unchanging and eternal. Hebrews 13:8, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. The scripture said there is no shadow of turning unto God. Do you know there's only one time that there is not a shadow? When it's straight up. And the sun is directly over a peg or whatever. There's no shadow whatsoever. And the Bible says that there's no shadow of turning. Why? Because he's always dead over you, dead head, dead center, over you, watching you, going with you, being there with you. He's not 2 degrees to the left or 1 degree to the right. He'll never miss what you're going through in your life because there's no shadow of turning for him. That means he's always directly overhead for you. No wonder the scripture says, look up, for your redemption draweth nigh. Right over. There you are, Lord, right there. No shadow of turning. I don't have to wait for him to get there. That's where he's at. I don't have to say, hurry up, God, you're at 10 o'clock. Hurry up, God, you're at 11 o'clock. And that's what we do a lot of times, whether we realize it or not. But we got to realize he's right there all the time, 24/7, dead over us, taking care of us, watching for us. And just like, if we get ready to close here in a minute, just like the Father, Jesus gives eternal life, John 10:27-28. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. I got to read that again. My sheep hear my voice. Now, we know that part, and we talk about that a lot. And I know them. And they follow me. And in one place it says, in another voice they'll not follow. And I give them eternal life. And they shall never perish. See, no other religion gives you eternal life. No other religion guarantees you eternal life. At best, all they can do is hope that your good outweighs your bad. And if your good outweighs your bad, then you've got a chance of making it. but they can't guarantee, Islam won't guarantee you heaven or paradise, as they call it, unless you literally take the life of an infidel. Everything else, there's no guarantee at all. So you hope that your good outweighs your bad. Listen, if I've got to wait for all of my good to outweigh my bad, most of us might get caught short. But when I came to Jesus Christ, it wasn't about my good outweighing my bad. It was about me saying, yes, Lord, I'm a sinner. I need you. I need your salvation and your redemption. And he says, because you've called upon my name and been obedient to the word, I save you and I give you eternal life, and you will never perish. But yeah, but my body's going to die. Your body might die, but you live forever. We just make a transition. Man, no other faith can offer this. So when we get an amalgamation of all of these religions into one world religious system, and they've come to me and says, well, we're going to have to kind of take and give and take a little from you and a little from you and a little from you and a little from you. You ain't going to take my eternal life. You ain't going to take my Jesus. You ain't going to take my God. I'm not going to settle for him to be lowered to a prophet. I'm not going to settle for him to be lowered to a teacher. I'm not going to settle for hoping I might make heaven. I know I'll make heaven if I have Jesus Christ in my heart and in my life. It's a guaranteed thing. But we're going to be faced with these things in a short time. Just like the Father Jesus is all-knowing. John 21, 17. And he, Peter, said unto him, Lord, you know all things. You know I love you. And Jesus said unto him, yes, feed my sheep. You know that's the hardest thing for a pastor to do. Everybody wants to be friends. Everybody wants to speak good things. You know the hardest thing I have to do is to feed the sheep. That's my job. And that simply means to give you the word of God. Not always my opinions, but the word of God. Feed my sheep. You got to give them the meat. John 16:30 says, now we are sure that you know all things and have no need that anyone should question you. Jesus, you know all things. You know everything. Isn't that awesome? But isn't that challenging? Sometimes it can be really challenging because, you know, sometimes we'll do something and we'll say something and we'll go like, well, God, you know my heart, and fail to realize he really does know your heart. Yeah, I do know it. I know what you're thinking. But it's easy for us to kind of justify some things and simply say, well, Lord, you know my heart. That one hit home, Scott. Makes us, yeah. Yeah, and he does. Amazing. Just like the Father, Jesus is everywhere. Matthew 18:20, for where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there in the midst of them. That means tonight, because we got more than two or three. It means he's here. Yeah, he's here. He never leaves us, never forsakes us. It always goes with us. And that's powerful for us to realize. He lives within us. Amen. Amen. One more scripture and we'll close. I probably said that earlier. Jeremiah 23:24, can anyone hide himself in secret places so I shall not see him, says the Lord? This is so awesome. Do I not fill heaven and earth, says the Lord? Lord, are you? Open your eyes. But I've looked to the heavens. You didn't open your eyes. I've looked around. You haven't opened your eyes. I fill heaven and earth. There's no place you can go that you don't touch me. You can't run. You can't hide. I'm everywhere. I fill everything. Amazing. All you got to do is reach out. He's there. Heal it. We used to sing a chorus years ago, reach out and touch the Lord as he passes by. He's everywhere. Everywhere. I'm closing for now. If you want to know the names of the organizations, I'll get you a copy of the notes. I just didn't want to throw them out there necessarily. Some of the organizations that you may have family and friends in. I have no problem with Islam because I've worked in Islamic nations for 25, 30 years now. And I see how it's played out. And when I hear states in the union that are wanting to legalize the Sharia law, I'm going like, you have no concept of the door that you're opening. None whatsoever. You just don't. Because if you had any inclination, you would run as far from it as you possibly could. Anyhow. You didn't want to be rude. I understand. These things, Tony, these things all slip in so easily. We were listening to a Christian station over Christmas, and somebody on there was praying for somebody. And and they were looking for, well, we want all of the positive energy that we can get. Well, I kind of know what they're probably think they're saying. We just don't want people to speak negative, speak positive, the word, and so forth. But even when we use phrases like that, we have to be really cautious that we don't enter in and begin to accept the New Age understanding. Listen, positive energy, as long as what you're really saying, and this is what you need to say, is I believe in speaking the powerful word of God. Or I shall have whatsoever I saith. That's positive. It's not your positive energy. It's you speaking positively about the power of the creator of the universe. And that, my friend, is a huge, huge difference. I speak God's word over you, all right, that you will overcome. Tomorrow night is New Year's. And I know many of you are going to be celebrating with your family. Take time to pray tomorrow night and just simply say, Father, as we go into 2021, we're going in with power and authority, and we're worshiping a true living God, Jesus Christ, the Lord. Amen? And you do that. That's the most powerful thing that you can do. all right, is to affirm whom you believe in. It is. If you, they can't. If, you know, people talk about backsliding and falling away. If you're rooted and grounded in the Word of God, doesn't mean trials won't come your way. As I said earlier, we most everybody in this room has went through a trial this year. But we've come out victorious. And we're going to continue to be victorious. Can't walk away. Yep. Jesus in. Well, Jesus looked to Peter and said, Peter, are you going to leave me? And Peter looked at him, John chapter 6, around verses 60, 61, right in that area. He said, where else am I going to go? Only you have the words of truth and life. There's no place to go. No place. God love you. God bless you. Happy New Year to you. Have a great one. 2021. Men's breakfast. I heard him talking about a tornado.